as I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over.
Everybody, come on, we encourage you to stand to your feet this morning. Come on, let's put our hands together. Come on, let's start this morning off with praise. Come on.
This is the day that you have made. Whatever comes, I won't complain. For all my hope is in your name, and now your joy.
In everything, give thanks. This morning, just get something on your mind to thank Him for. Come on, let's sing this out. Here we go.
And as we lift our hands up, heaven's open, heaven's open. So let our lives declare the love our God has spoken over us.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Come on, give Him praise today. He is worthy and worthy to be praised. He is great and greatly to be praised. Welcome to day 16 of the 21 days of prayer. Big hello to all of you joining us from your cars and from home. from your kitchens with your kids. So glad you're here. Grab a seat. We're going to get started. Here we are on the third week. And way to go, everybody. Way to press through and way to be here as we have come through a season of getting close to God and then asking God to do some work on the inside of us. And now we've come and asking God for this third week. God put us to work to intercede. And what intercession is really standing like an attorney, you know, in front of God and saying, Lord, on their behalf, and we're pleading the case for others. And so all this week, we're going to be praying over a variety of different things, but we're really asking God to make us the kind of church that he can use. Amen, somebody? I mean, we're not just here just to go to church. We are the church, and God has a plan and a purpose for us. So I want to get right into that today, and I want to show you a verse that Jesus said, and this is a great comfort to me that I don't have to build a church. Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail or be able to withstand it. So I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. And that's a powerful thought, that Jesus himself is at work. He's the one that wants to build his church. It's so personal to him. And the purpose of Jesus on the earth today, if he was here just like he came originally, was that he came to change people's lives. He didn't come to start a church service. I think sometimes we think that church is an hour on Sunday, or the church is a place that you go and you visit. You know, I got to get back to church. But really, I want us to have an understanding that his church is people. His church is a group of people. It's a living thing, and we are the different pieces of it, his body. And God didn't put his church on earth so that they could gather once a week and go home and live their lives. He called us to be his church so that we could be on mission with him. So Jesus came to change the world. So we're not here just to go to church. We're here to change the world as well. And so that's what Ephesians 3 talks about, where he says it's through the church that the manifold wisdom of God. I know you don't use that word manifold in your daily vocabulary, but think about that. The many-folded, the multifaceted, or maybe the multidimensional. Or maybe think of that big box I had up here yesterday. You know, the balanced, like that through God, all of his character, all his different sides would be known. And the world desperately needs that today. They need to see the glory and the character of God. And what he's promised is he's promised his personal involvement. That little verse, if you could just put that back up again, it says, and just leave them up today. As long as I have verses up there, we're just going to keep reading them. But he says, I'll do it. So if you say, I'm going to be a part of the church of Jesus, then that means he's promised personal involvement in your life. Can you believe that? Like, he wants to actually be involved in using you to accomplish something far bigger than you would have ever imagined for yourself. And we're going to talk about that today. And actually, our church began with a simple idea that if we're going to come here and begin a new church, what does that church look like? What's that church supposed to feel like? What's the culture of that church? What's the personality? Like if people met Jesus, what did they encounter? What did they feel? What did they see? What did they experience? And so much more than a mission statement, I was consumed with this 21 years ago. When I gathered the first little group of people, I said, what kind of church are we going to be? And we just started to read scripture. We just started to read verses about who Jesus was. I want to do that very same exercise. I want to take us back 21 years and do exactly what we did 21 years ago when there were just a handful of people meeting in the living room. The shortest gospel of the four is the book of Mark, and it's one of the ones that I love the most because it's so active. Like, Jesus is doing something in almost every verse, and I just want to read a few verses because we can see Jesus and what he's like. And here he is. When the church started, Mark chapter 1, verse 16, one day as Jesus was walking along the shore of the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew, and they were throwing a net in the water, for they fished for a living. They're just regular guys. They had a job. They worked for their dad. They fished. And you didn't need any education to do that. These were uneducated men. They just grew up fishing. And Jesus called out to them and said, come, follow me. And I think kind of with a smile on his face, I'll show you how to really fish. I'll show you how to fish for people. And that was the beginning of the church right there, where Jesus called the first people to come to him. And they left their nets at once and they followed him. That's pretty amazing. A little farther up the shore, they see Zebedee and sons fishing company. And James and John are there repairing the nets. And he called to them, and they also followed him. And leaving their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men. And Jesus now and these new companions, they went to a town of Capernaum where the Sabbath day was. It was when the Sabbath came, he goes into the synagogue and he begins to teach, and the people are just amazed at his teaching. And while he's teaching, a man in the synagogue possessed of an evil spirit cried out, "Why are you interfering with us, Jesus?" You know why that happened? Because people were sitting there feeling like, he's talking to me, like he knows my life, like the words he's saying right now are so real, and it was bringing hope to people, and the demonic spirits that were oppressing people were freaking out. They're like, we're losing control, and this guy jumps up and starts manifesting out, and Jesus, you know, I know who you are. You're the Holy One. And Jesus rebuked him and said, be quiet, come out of the man. And at that, the evil spirit screamed, threw the man into a convulsion. Now, that was a day to go to church. I mean, you didn't want to stay home. They said, like, what happened at church today? I can't even describe it. Like, you need to go catch it online. It was amazing. And this evil spirit came out of him. And watch this. Here's one of the pictures of what it felt like to be around Jesus. Amazement. Amazement gripped the audience. And they began to discuss what had happened. What kind of teaching is this? Like, this isn't a history lesson. Like, stuff's happening now. He has such authority, and even evil spirits obey his orders. Jesus leaves the synagogue, and he's tired. He's preached all day. But with James and John, and they go to Simon and Andrew's home. Notice how, like, just really is. Like, let's go to your house. And now Simon's mother-in-law was sick there with a high fever. They told Jesus about her right away, so he went to her bedside. You ever been over at somebody's house and someone's sick and you're just the guest? I mean, Jesus is like, hey, take me to her. Like, take me up in her room. And he took her by the hand and he helped her sit up. And the fever left her, and she came down, prepared a meal for them, which is what she probably wanted to do. That evening after sunset, so the day's over, they should be going to bed. But many sick and demon-possessed people, they didn't go to the church, they came to the house. And the whole town gathered at the door to watch. So Jesus healed many people who were sick with various diseases. He cast out many demons. But it's not over. Like, the next morning, it's still early. It's not even dark. Sun is not even up. And Jesus, even though he was late, staying up late helping people, he gets up and goes to prayer. Jesus got up, left the house, found a solitary place where he prayed because he was dependent on his father. Later, Simon and the others, they went out to find him. Where are you? We're looking for you. Everyone's looking for you. Jesus replied, well, it's not just here. We have to go to other towns. Other people need to hear. Do you see Jesus's whole idea, like his whole being, like we have to reach people. We have to bring people good news. We have to help people. I'll preach to them too. This is why I came, was to help people. Then this man with leprosy came and knelt in front of Jesus, and he begged to be healed. And watch his words. If you're willing, you can heal me and you can make me clean. And he said, and then Jesus moved with compassion. Like, he stopped. I mean, he's got a mission. He's going to preach for people, but he stopped what he was doing and moved with compassion. He reached out and touched him and said, I'm willing. Be healed. And instantly the leprosy disappeared. I could just keep reading the book of Mark. It goes on like this, like stuff is happening. But 21 years ago, we started reading this together, and we said, okay, let's just pull out some words. What are some of the words that you see that describe what it's like to meet Jesus and encounter Jesus and to be in his presence? And what's it like when we're all with him? What does it feel like? And the conclusion was, after that whole exercise, is we want to be a church like that. We want to be a church that looks like and feels like and represents, and people come into the presence of the Lord, and that's what happens. So what was it like? Let me show you some adjectives. Wasn't he accepting? I mean, he just picked ordinary people. He wasn't looking for special people or the people with the best resumes. He just chose ordinary people to come be with him. And sinners, and later tax collectors, and people who were prostitutes, and people who were the down and outers, and people who knew they needed God. He just said, come, you can follow me. And then he was so authentic. He was just real. Like, he wasn't up on his high horse. He wasn't withdrawn from the crowds. He wasn't, you know, just hiding behind an entourage. He just, like, take me to him. And he cared, and he didn't withdraw, and he would stop what he would be doing to look you in the eye and figure out what your need was. And he was so observant. And I even think that helped him when he was speaking, because he would say things that was right to the issues of where people were, and they'd be like, he must be in my house somehow. How does he know? And then he was God-dependent, right? Because early in the morning, he's tired, but he gets up because I know I need to hear from God. I need his power. I need to hear what he has to say. I need his direction. And then he was powerful because, I mean, just a word and people would be healed. And just a word and demons would leave people alone. And just a word and the darkness would leave somebody or whatever had them under. You know, wouldn't we need that today? That's what I'm crying out for. God, do that again. Like, God, give the church the ability to pray for people. And the darkness just has to go. The demonic oppression, the whatever's on young people today, Lord, I just pray that we could pray and that would just be gone in Jesus' name. So he's all of these things. You have to understand, we don't want people just to go to a church. We don't need people to come to a church service and hear a person and hear some music. They need to encounter you guys, filled with the Spirit of God. And together, somehow, no one person can be Jesus, right? But if all of us are filled with the Spirit of God and God using our different gifts, somehow, God promises, Jesus said, through you guys, I'll just build my church and you guys will look like me. And I think that's what God is doing. I think that's what God had in mind, to pull people together and help them see something beyond themselves and say, you can represent me and you can be me. And when people come and find you, we can be his hands and feet. In fact, he goes on to say, look, if Jesus said, if you see me, you've seen the Father. And so skip on to that last verse. We're out of time. We got to go to John chapter 14, verse 9. And let me just give you this last verse. It's not just Jesus that did those things. You know what he said to his disciples? Look at this last verse. He said, I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works that I have done and even greater works, because I'm going to be with the Father. But listen, people, on Monday morning, day 16, you can ask anything in my name and I will do it so that the Son can bring glory to the Father. Yes, he said, ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. You know what I want to do? Put this up on the screen. I want us to pray today. God, help us to look like Jesus. That is the prayer that I know he'll answer. He said, if you ask anything in my name, I'll do it. Well, I guarantee you, you pray, God, help us to look like you. God, build your church to look like you again. God, let's be done with pretense and program and be done with all of the trappings of it all. I'll surrender all of that if God will bring Mark chapter 1 back again. I'll trade it all just for that. How about you? You want to pray that today? Will you stand to your feet? Let's pray this prayer. God, we pray you will help us to look like you today. God, we trade our thoughts for your thoughts. We pray that the atmosphere of heaven, the thoughts of heaven, would come to us today. We forget earthly things. We lift our eyes to you. We worship you one more time. We give you praise. Direct our prayers today. Make us like you in Jesus' name. Amen.
First, there's prayer cards available down at the front, and then the prayers, of course, on the wall. Let's go and pray for everyone, and we will meet back for corporate prayer at 6:45.
Come. crushing and the pressing.
God, the work of Calvary. Withholding nothing.
Come on, you say
I surrender.
They haven't seen what
Come on, let's just lift up the name of Jesus. We love you, Lord. We magnify you. We praise your name. There is no one like you. We worship your mighty name. You are wonderful counselor. You're the mighty God. You're the everlasting Father. You are the Prince of Peace, and you rule over our hearts and our lives today. And we just declare that there's nothing too difficult for you, nothing too hard for you. There's nothing impossible for you. Lord, you are the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. You're the author and the finisher. We know that you are the provider. You're the comforter. You're the healer. Lord, your word says that you're our banner of victory. You fight our battles even before we encounter them. You've already given us the victory. Thank you, Lord, that there is none like you. Come on, just reach up and lift up your name, his name today. We love you, Lord. We bless your name. We think about how great you are. How great you are, that you are great and greatly to be praised. Your character is so beautiful. You're so balanced. You are merciful and you're mighty. God, you know how to be strong and you know how to be merciful. You know how to be clear and you know how to be patient. God, I pray you'd make us like you. Today, Lord, we come to you asking you to let the image of your Son be made on the inside of us. Lord, we pray that we would take on his character. The way he thinks, the way he would walk, the way he would look at people, the way he would stop. Lord, I pray that you would give us his heart, this mission that he had to reconcile people who are far from you and bring them back to the Father. God, we pray that we would have that kind of heart. God, we just pray that you would give us Jesus' strengths and his attitudes, and God, that his glory would just rest upon us, that, Lord, each one of us, you would smile on us and say that we are your sons and your daughters and in whom you're well pleased. Lord, we pray you'd fill us with your Holy Spirit today. God, we pray that we would be filled with your very nature and your character. Let the fruit of the Spirit just come out of us today. Your love and your joy and your peace and your long-suffering, Lord, your forbearance. God, I thank you for the goodness, Lord, of the balance of your character that you can grow out of us today. Thank you for bringing faithfulness and gentleness and kindness. Thank you for self-control. God, I pray that you give us the ability to help us to be quick to listen and slow to get angry and just slow to speak, Lord. I pray that you would give us the character of Jesus today. God, we pray your anointing and your presence on us as a church. God, we ask you, Lord, to come and oversee everything of who we are. We don't want to just be in the natural. We just don't want to build a monument. We don't want to just build a place. God, we want to be your people on the earth. Build us, oh God. Come build your church. Can I get an amen? Can anybody pray this prayer with me today? God, would you lay your hands on us and anoint us and bless us, God, that we could go out and we could have the eyes to see and the ears to hear, and Lord, that we could lay hands on people and they would recover, and that the sick would be healed, and that those who are suffering depression and oppression and they have no ability to know what to do, God, we could pray and they would be set free and there would be light in the darkness. God, we pray that we would walk and be like a city shining on that hill, Lord, a group of people that declare the glory and the beauty and the diversity and the wonder of God. God, I pray that you would make us so beautifully balanced, a church that is absolutely committed to you and to your word. But Lord, we are as merciful and as compassionate and as patient as you were. And God, we pray for wisdom, godly wisdom. Lord, we don't know how to answer, but Lord, we know that you'll put the right words in our mouth at every occasion. That God, we can listen to your Spirit and you can be that voice in our ear, and a hand on our shoulder and a light on our path. God, I pray you'd anoint us with authenticity. God, help us to be real. Help us to just not to put on fake spirituality and religion, Lord. We reject that in Jesus' name. And we just pray that we would be naturally, confidently filled with just the Spirit of Jesus. Let us walk with a holy
a holy sense of your presence on our lives today. God, we pray you would unite us, Lord, beyond what's in the natural. God, I pray that you would use us to build bridges to people. God, I pray that we could be people that stand somehow in the gap and are able to bring people together and unite people. I pray that unity is so beautiful. God, I pray it just flows down onto every person, all the way down to our children, to every person that's connected to us. Let it be just a beautiful unity, a sense of your peace. Lord, you said you would be the Prince of Peace on earth. Come be your peace on the inside of us. Let us be peacemakers in this world today. God, we need to be dependent on you. So we come today early before the sun rises. And Lord, we come and lift up the sun. We lift up your name. We lift up who you are. We thank you that you're our Lord and Savior. And we pray today that you would be the source of our life. When we don't know what to do, we'll just stop and breathe and ask you for wisdom. Or maybe we'll stop and ask you for the spirit of forgiveness. Or maybe we'll just stop and say, Lord, cleanse my mind right now. Lord, take away these thoughts. Lord, I pray that you would bring me into alignment with your holiness, Lord. Pour your power and your spirit upon us today. God, make us clean. Make us vessels that you can inhabit. Lord, I pray that there would be no deceit in us. No anger, no bitterness, no controversy, just people, men and women that love to lift up our hands and praise you and worship you. And Lord, when we don't know what to do, Lord, we'll turn to you and we'll trust you. And God, I pray you'd embolden us, give us faith to do the very thing that you said, that we would do greater things. And Lord, why not now? Why not now when the world is so dark? Why can't we do the greater things that you promised? Lord, you said that if we asked you, that it would be done to bring glory to the Father through the Son. And so, Lord, there's no greater prayer that we can pray today than say, Lord, make us like you. Make us humble like you. Lord, you just said all you require is that we act justly and we love mercy and walk humbly with you, our God. And God, I pray that you would transform us. Give us vision to be that today. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done in us today. Now, Lord, I just pray together. I join with my brothers and sisters. We pray for young people, and we pray for children. We pray for teenagers. God, send us a supernatural revival to the next generation. God, we pray against depression and anxiety, and we pray that the lost will be found, and the lonely would be drawn in, and every young person would know their purpose, God, and it would bring faith and joy to their heart. God, I pray for those that you love right now. Their names are on the wall. We love them, Lord. Lord, children that have turned away, God, turn their hearts not only back to you, but back to their mothers and fathers today, Lord. I pray that there would just be an awakening, a hunger, and a desire for you. May they, when they come, Lord, may they encounter you, God. I pray that there would be something so fresh and so new and so real blowing amongst us in these next few months, Lord. God, give us a revival of salvations like we've never seen before. God, I pray more people come to know you, that aha moment where they just realize they need you. God, we're not gonna just, it's not for our glory. We're not gonna misuse that or brag on us. Lord, we give you the glory right now. Lord, we wanna see people come to know you through us, your church. And Lord, I just pray this prayer again. Lord, I'm no longer my own, but I'm yours. Direct me to what you will. Place me with whom you will. Put me to work for you or put me to suffering for you. Either way, Lord, let me be employed by you or you can lay me aside. God, I just want what you want. Exalted for you or brought low for you. God, I pray that my heart would either be just full today, or God, if I need to be empty today, so be it, Lord. Let me have all things or have nothing. I wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and your disposal. And now, O glorious God and our blessed God, our Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you're mine. Just say that. Say, Lord, you are mine and I am yours. Say that part again. You are mine and I am yours. God, we just surrender to you. And may the covenant that we make right now here on earth be ratified in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen and amen, amen. We surrender to you, Lord. Amen. I just believe as you pray that little surrender prayer today and you keep coming back to that, you keep coming every morning these next few days, I know God's going to do something in us. He's going to unite us and he's going to answer this prayer. God, I pray you make us not for our glory, but just make us the church that works. Actually, that just came to me right now. Wouldn't that be great? Not a church that just is, but a church that actually works and touches people and changes the world. Come on. God, I just pray, make us a church that works today. Work in us and work through us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Go have the best Monday. Let God work through you. See you back tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. We love you guys. God bless you.